Tony Cox.
Hi, Tony.
I chair the RPI CPI News. I was interested in your comments about your lack of teeth to discipline bad behaviour where you find it. And that surely places much more emphasis on those soft powers that you do have. And I'm thinking of a particular example in terms of the National Statistic Brand. And last November, I think it was, when the National Statistician made a statement that he wanted to make the CPI average, one of the price indices, the main and preferred price index statistic from this March. As some people may know, the CPIH lost its national statistics status, had it suspended some time ago, and you are currently reviewing its status. But that review is by no means complete yet. So I just invite you to comment on how you feel about the national statistician making a statement like that ahead of the CPIH giving that brand of approval.
I will do, but can I just, before I do so, is it permitted to respond to the discussant's responses? Is that within the rules?
I'm sure. Okay.
Is that permitted?
Yes.
So, I think Paul highlighted lots of things which I think we need to unravel and debate more. The media, the quantitative skills, the mousetraps, I think that's really good. I just wanted to clarify a point about value. Now, it may appear as though users are invisible, to use your phrase. They are absolutely not, but there's a very, very conscious choice in using the term value as opposed to users, or a conscious choice reflecting two concerns. First concern is, I think that if you go to most statistical producers and you say, you know, do you care about users' needs? You will get a response which is based around a process called a thing called user engagement. And that is a process of, well, we have X, Y, Z conversations, and we have ABC consultations. And I think that sucks the whole thing back into a process which is sort of like not particularly meaningful, or has the risk of not being meaningful. What we want to say is it's got to be valuable for the people who are receiving it. So value, just to show that you've engaged with users, that you've had a certain number of meetings, is not a sufficient condition for us. It's got to be something which generates insight. The second point, and you touched on this, Paul, very, very, very well, why value is that there's a really deliberate differentiation, and I'll be very explicit about this, differentiation from the national statisticians' articulation of better statistics, better decisions. Because I think in that there is often an unsaid interpretation that statistics are for quote unquote decision makers, and those decision makers are often institutional. They're often within institutions. And I think that's not what public statistics, that's not the only purpose of public statistics, it's a purpose. I think you had a lovely point that statistics are for debate, for information, for evaluation. And I think those things are hugely publicly valuable. They are the sort of the heart of what the value of statistics are. Because if you just needed statistics for decision makers, you could just privately process information. You wouldn't need to publish it. You know, there might be some transparency rules saying we made this decision on that information. But it's not the same thing as saying, this is the knowledge that we are curating, stewarding for society, so society can better understand. So we focus on value, not to make users invisible, but to make why they matter more important. Users is not a process, and they're not kind of an afterthought to decision makers. It's actually valuable to the public, which is the heart of everything you say. So I just wanted to clarify that, if that hadn't been clear already. That's really, really a key point, this notion of value. On what I feel about the history of CPIH, I suppose at one level, the national statistician can inform the world of his preferred or headline or main or whatever the phrase is, main measure at any time. And to some extent, that's a judgment that he can make. For me, what I'm focusing on is, does this meet the criteria for for trustworthiness, for quality, and for value. And as you will know, Tony, we have had concerns, particularly in three kind of relatively technical areas around quality assurance underpinning CPIH, around the comparison of CPIH, and around the sort of technical user engagement, not user engagement as a process, but as a way of engaging with technical experts. And we stick with those things. I think that, I think that John can make that choice if he wants. But for me, it doesn't really impact on my judgment about whether something's a national statistic or not. There was a hand up over here.
Yeah, I'm Richard Bullmer, former head of statistics at the Department of Health. Very much welcome what you're doing. But I think in line with Paul's sort of wider thing, when the stats authority was first set up, the big thing was about public confidence and public perceptions. Now, do we know whether public confidence is better or worse than 9 or 10 years ago? Is someone looking at the outside, looking in type thing? And I'm thinking of the public, I'm thinking of working with the media on all this massive data and how we build confidence with the public in those things. So there's a sort of out of ring of stuff to be done in all of what you said.
So there is a thing called public confidence in official statistics, which is a two-yearly survey, and the latest results are imminent, in fact, next week Monday, but on the basis that I have 2 weeks access, I don't even know what they say. I'll be failing my own lines if I kind of even had 3 weeks access, much less blabbed what the results were. So the results next Monday. If you look at the past iterations, actually since 2007, that has showed a really, really interesting kind of bifurcation in public confidence. On the one hand, public confidence in official statistics has tended to maintain or increase, whereas public confidence in the use of those statistics in media and in our politicians has tended to decrease, which now to some extent that's terrible. To another extent, I think it does give us some assurance that the regime that we've put in place since 2008 is kind of insulating official statistics from the kind of wider turmoil of declining trust and expertise and so on. So there is that sense of outside the system view, but watch out for Monday, because it could be that, you know, I really regret having just said that, if the figures on Monday are terrible, and you know, there's kind of plausible reasons why they might be, given you know, the sort of political environment. So,
obviously, one of the changes that's taken place, well, since before the Statistics and Regulation Act, but obviously written in the Code of Practice, which is the separation of the idea that the statistics should be launched and presented press conferences by statisticians, not by ministers, and in order to stop the the abuse by ministers that happened before then, and all those changes are welcome, but you can find many examples where it hasn't done that, and what you do about that. That, for example, misuse, all the dispute about weekend mortality,
yeah,
24-hour health,
yeah,
service. And, for example, in the case of maternity services, Dr. Foster's wrote the analysis which gave Jeremy Hunt what he wanted to stitch up the junior doctors on that. I'm a bit biased because we've been doing a project which was meant to produce more reliable analysis, but we've been held back so long by access to data and all sorts of technical problems. We've come at the end of our funding and we can't actually do the more reliable analysis. And if they're judging about whether they need our analysis, well, no, Dr. Foster's have got an article which produces what Jeremy Hunt wants. It's in the BMJ, so it must be right. And you know, that I mean, the protest went even to that junior doctors had a wrote a letter to the minister about his use of statistics, which, having tried to teach statistics to medical students, I was very pleased to see junior doctors. and you know, had a photo call in freezing cold, presenting a huge mock-up of a book on how to read a paper. And so, but this was just completely ignored. And they also gave an example, which in their review body report, data which were not yet published, but were released and made available to the review body, which was chaired by our Vice Chancellor, who was knighted in last year's New Year's Honours list. So, I mean, those sorts of abuses, because these aren't anything of your kite mark, but it's, you know, it's what, it's giving the minister what they want to believe. You know, he wants to reduce the stillbirth rate, and we're told by obstetricians and midwives, yes, we get them out alive, of course they die quite soon afterwards. So it's another rate that goes up. That sort of thing, and it's giving the politicians what they want, and perhaps the GSS in wanting quality and everything else isn't giving them. And there's organisations, I say, particularly Dr. Foster, Brian Jarman, you name them, who provide what they want.
So there's a great deal in there. Let me
pull
out a few strands. I think the first is, I wouldn't deny that the dragons to slay are many and fearsome.
You
know, doing all of this is not wanting to say, well, we're going to stick in the walled garden and where everything is kind of quite nice and rosy. We're actually going out into the wild lands outside. And it, actually, if you look at the what we call the interventions, the things that we've been doing since the auditors launched, we've been, I would say, quite a lot bolder. We criticised the Department for Education quite strongly for a tweet that they produced, not really an official statistic at all. This week we've done two quite big things. One on the leaks of NHS data. You may have seen that letter that I wrote to NHS England and a couple of other bodies. We've also this week focused on misuse of homelessness statistics. But we have to do that. We have to be assertive because the dragons to slay are many and fearsome. So that's the first thing. Second thing, actually, having said that, I do believe in the core integrity of the UK's statistical system, and the whole point I'm making about reach is that the reach of that integrity should go beyond what's currently defined as official statistics, because the principles are universal. And where you see departments, and actually having been unkind about DfE about 15 seconds ago, DfE are really good at this, of saying, well, let's think about how we can present this information in a way that sort of respects the sort of philosophy of treating the public with respect. I think there are lots of dragons to slay, but I do believe in the core integrity of the system. And then a final point to pull out of what you said is, if I look back at all of the things that we've been involved with in my time at the authority, which is going back to the start of 2014, I think that if I had my time again, I would like to play the excess weekend deaths a bit more sensibly. I think we could have been a bit more sensitive.
Well, I mean, now NHS Digital produces sort of experimental statistics. I mean, their worst data, they're experimental statistics. And these are produced using the methods favoured by Chief Medical Officer of NHS England, which has been criticised because they're using his methods because they show the weekend excess. So that seems to me a bit dishonest, and there's no sort of peer review in that. And then, I mean, there's things which you can't help, like another example is where there's some statistics on the NHS Digital website, which at every page it says in proper statistical terms, these data are crap, handled with care, but that's their female genital mutilation statistics. But the press will report them in all sorts of different ways, and I don't know what you can do about that. I mean, I've written the paper several times.
I'll just go back to my earlier comment that I believe the system has integrity. I think we need to extend its boundaries and its ambition. And in doing so, there are drivers to slide.
Yeah. And that's the case where they said on every page that these are crap. So how do we work with you on that? I mean,
I think we have quite a lot of other questions.
So, a positive question, how do we work with you on that? I think that's a generic one. Don't answer it now.
A couple of questions from over on that side of the room. There's a man sitting at the far back. What would you like to go?
Me? Yes. Oh, Harvey Goldstein, University of Bristol. Thanks very much, Ed. It was very informative. In many ways, more power to your arm. But I want to raise a more general question. Because for many users, the official statistics as they're published are actually only the beginning of the statistical investigation. What you really want to do is get your hands on the individual data.
Yeah.
For example, I mean, take education that I know a fair bit about. What the DfE produces is very interesting. It produces data right down to the level of school, but these essentially are aggregated data. And most statistical analysts coming along will say that's very interesting, but I'm a little bit kind of concerned about that and what the implications are. What I really want to do is to get down to the individual data and do a proper statistical analysis, model these, and introduce uncertainties and all the rest of it. Now, of course, the DfE is actually very good because they make available the National Pupil Database upon which all their statistics, these kinds of statistics, are actually from which they're derived. And those are pretty freely available to researchers. And that's actually a shining example, I have to say, among government departments as a whole, including ONS. But my question is a general question. There seems to me a division of responsibilities. You're responsible for official statistics as they're published, essentially an aggregated form.
Yeah.
But as I understand it, government policy, and policy of most politicians in the era of big data, is to go much further and to talk about making data available, micro data available, on a far wider basis, partly, and maybe largely, through the linking of administrative and possibly other data sets, and of course ONS. And some other government departments already being involved in that. And NHS Digital, that Alison mentioned, has been involved in that for several years. But a lot of the responsibility for making those data available, and those data are often the crucial data to answer certain questions, is not you at all. It's people like the Information Commissioner's Office, or, for example, health data, or people like the Confidentiality Advisory Group, Department of Health, and so on. It's scattered around, it's not brought together. You didn't mention, nobody's yet mentioned, the Digital Economies Bill, which is now through the House of Lords, which actually doesn't say a great deal, as Alan said, about official statistics, but actually has quite a lot about microdata, who shall have access to it, how it should be coordinated, how it should be linked, and so on. A lot of it, in my view, is not at all clear. I mean, actually, have been worked out when the bill becomes law. But it's not your responsibility, and yet we talk about statistics and statisticians.
We think
of statistics not just as tables and summaries. We think of analysing statistics. Now, you work within a certain legal framework, so it's not fair to say to you what's your opinion. But I do want to draw some attention to this because I think in the future, people are going to be moving away from using what you produce or you're responsible for overseeing to actually getting to grips with the data at a micro level. And that's something that I think the government needs to wake up to. And we as statisticians need to continue to press for that. But it'd be interesting to have your comments on
that. So I think you're being too soft on me. You said, well, it's not my job to have a I think we should have a position on this. And I think we do. And there are sort of two components to it. The first is that we say that whenever official statistics are published, it's the responsibility of the producer to make the micro data as available as possible, subject to the protection of the confidentiality of the individual. And we do, through our sort of compliance with the code work, push at that, and we will sometimes push producers to say, you know, you need to be more open with the underlying microdata that creates this aggregated picture. And I think that's, coming back to this question of users, I think that's because that's what users find creates the value for them. It's not just the aggregated picture, exactly as you say. So we do push on that. But I think there's another kind of richer sense that I think we have a responsibility here. And that is that I think some statistics that are published at present are kind of not very interesting administrative counts. And the real value comes when those separated individual counts are joined together. Let me use an example. I know there's some people from DWP here, so apologies. This is a DWP example. There's statistics on foreign-born people who register for national insurance numbers. And they're, you know, pretty high-quality numbers. They count people who are coming through the system reasonably faithfully. But because those figures are used in discourse to shine a light on migration, but they don't really say very much about the hazards of doing so, how much reliance should be made on them, and they're certainly not linked with other sources that could really tell you how many of those vulnerable people who are registering are actually active in the labour market, we say the value's not there, we expect to see a much more linked picture. So in terms of the two components, one is in any individual statistic which is produced, we really expect that the microdata are as available as possible, and we really encourage that. And where there are major confidentiality concerns, we're increasingly expecting people to use safe facilities like ADRN to make data available. And then there's a bigger sense of saying actually where the value would come from the linking. We're starting to push the linking. Let me say one other thing, just to see the process of DFE again. They do this amazing longitudinal educational outcomes thing, which is, I think, the poster child for linked data. I mean, you must be more familiar with it than I do. It's an amazing interlinked database that they're creating, linking National People Database to a whole range of other adult data sets, so you can track people's kind of life functions. Now, at one level, that's probably not quite official statistics. There's not a kind of regular official statistics read, but I think that what they're doing is they're creating a statistical asset of immense value. So I think it's absolutely our territory, in short answer to the question. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll just say,
Guy Goodwin from the Chief Executive of the National Centre for Social Research. I think we're all sort of making the same comment here, but in different ways. And for me, the big challenge for statisticians, official statisticians going forward, is around relevance.
Yep.
And keeping their relevance. And there's a bit of the talk which I'm nodding at, but it feels as if you are in an enclosed garden. You're sort of defining and trying to define a statistics system, and you're trying to perhaps go outside and just bring a few bits in. And for me, that's missing something about the future and relevance. It's to do with data, but it's also Alison's comments as well, that there's almost, in my eyes, a bigger piece around politics, a sort of almost a crusade, getting some of us worked up about some of the things that are happening. So I'm thinking of all the data and information that's published by economists, researchers, the whole community of analytical community, if you call them that. A lot of it now happens outside of official statistics.
Absolutely.
There's no uncertainty measures put alongside a whole of it, not even basic metadata.
Yeah.
There's something about gathering the community, and in my eyes, and getting some basic rules. There are research reports that are buried.
Yeah.
There are all of that side. And I just think there might be something, another strand, which is a more political strand, where you do need to go beyond the boundaries and actually challenge some of these things. So what you say is fine within a fixed system. I just think there's a bit more that you might want to think about. Yeah.
I think that's a brilliant point. I mean, I don't really have a response other than to say, I hope somebody in my team is writing that down. That's a really, really very strong point.
Good afternoon.
Yes.
Martin
Jones
from Health Statistics Group, and particularly I mean, you can't disagree with trustworthiness, quality, and value, but when you're saying how much you want to appreciate the public's attitude to value, sh- shouldn't you also say how you're going to measure that? How exactly do you measure the value that the public put on these statistics? You've mentioned the survey that's coming out in 2 weeks' time. Is that how you measure it, or are you going to try and define other ways that you're going to measure the public value? And surely that should be stated, how you're going to measure it.
So,
and I'm just going to add, I think that journalists and editors of journals and standards, a bit like what Jennifer has just said, that certain standards of uncertainty and how we publish results and interpretation of statistics, and indeed the teaching of statistics, which has really been sort of belittled a bit, really.
I'm going to need more than my 25 people, aren't I, with all you lot helping me? Let me touch on value. I suppose there's a couple of ways you could think about this. One is you could say, well, you care about the public value of statistics. Many ways in society in which we place a value on things is to monetize, many valuations of public policy factors create kind of single aggregated monetary values. One thinks about an infrastructure project, people say it's got a net benefit of X million or X billion. One thinks of sorts of policy evaluations which say, well, this is a net positive benefit of whatever. And that's, I think, really, really hard for something which has got this heavily intangible quality of statistics. I think it's hard to monetize into a single, it's hard to monetize at any level, but particularly hard to monetize into a single aggregate figure. So the second way to think about it is to say that actually value is very, very context specific. So that the value of one set of statistics in one context could be defined by, and let's go back to this kind of paradigm of a decision maker, the decisions that it informs. But in another context, let me give an example of that, which is not about central government decision making. Annual population estimates. They are immensely valuable to local authorities for the resource allocation that it guides. And indeed, questions about the accuracy of those mid-year population estimates can be a fraught issue for some local authorities who will say, actually, we know we've got more people than the population estimate says we have, and therefore we can. So there's a real kind of context-specific use value there. I think there are other things, domains, scenarios, where actually that kind of instrumental value is pretty hard to kind of, with any real sort of precision, kind of define. And yet, we know that people will care about the performance of aspects of the public service. They will care about, and one thinks here about the health context, people will care about the outcomes that are recorded for individuals and how those are aggregated up. And that sort of caring sort of goes beyond the kind of use value. So I think the way we think about it is to not kind of search what I think would be a fruitless search for the kind of macro monetized public value. I think we say when we look at an individual set of statistics or a group of statistics, we say, how are these things used, and are those things used in ways, are the providers enabling people to use them in ways which meets their needs? It goes back to Paul's point. So I would resile from a kind of purely analytical answer to that question. I think it's much richer and more interesting. So that's my take on public value.
Question at the front?
Oh, indeed. Ajmal Hassan, University of Greenwich Business School, and my past role is with the Cabinet Office and the GSS. So thank you for your enlightened point of view on both sides. My question is, in fact, about the other side of the story. And quite rightly, we understood that there is an enclosed world, quite neat and tidy, and the emphasis has been quite rightly on how we produce statistics. And there's a lot we do when we go to work, and there's a lot of improvements, of course, as we know. So the question is, what happens on the other side when we know that there's 75% of course, the statistics coming out of non-official statistics world. And that number is increasing all the time. And as we also know, that we don't have to reach out to statistics. The statistics are coming to us through small data and big data, from the likes of Google, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, and so on. And so there's a bigger burden on the consumption side of the story, which we understand and regard, but it doesn't come through so well in the established order of things that we see. So to what extent we should work more closely with the consumption side, which is huge, and where the public interest has to be looked after more so increasingly. And that work is increasing in the light of actually Brexit, when we will be dealing not just with the new countries in terms of our connections, and we will not be looking at sending statistics for harmonization to the Eurostat world, but also to the rest of the world. So from a reach point of view, our statistics will have meaning and purpose to a larger community, and their influence are equally. So how prepared is the regulator to work with the so-called non-official statistics, which carry a bigger, heavier weight? And given that we're so close to the official statistics world, our background, our work histories, and our compliance with the rest of it, so we may have lots of blind spots where we may overlook the consumption story, in which there's a need, in fact, to talk to people who are the NGOs of statistics, the Amnesty International of statistics, human rights equivalents of statistics, very active. And what processes we have to benefit from that work, so to keep ourselves on our feet, and work with the value part of the statistics that we claim we need to produce in public interest, as opposed to relying on official statistics, where increasingly the amount of statistics coming out of the official world is getting limited, narrow, and there'll come a time when we will not need it, because the internet will produce all the statistics we need. The big question is, how do we use what we have in the interest of public value, safety, truthfulness, and the rest? So these are big questions for the regulator.
They are big questions, and I guess what I'm going to say, I'm about to say, may sound a bit, maybe sound a bit blasé, and I apologise for it in advance, because these are big questions, and I think it's quite a long haul to kind of address that broader consumption world that you define. But so my quick answer is to say, this office is driven by two things in parallel. One is, there is this official statistics system. It's really good. There are some things which can work better about it. We can enhance it, and we can enhance the way that we help it be good. So that's kind of one thing. We can make our system better. But the second thing is, we need to reach out beyond it, precisely for the reasons that you give, and I think Guy gave, and I think actually Alison gave as well, that you know, there are it's almost as if the act that we were working to was written in a world in which there was official statistics and not much else, and we now know there's a world of official statistics. And I was going to flash up my thing of the different bubbles of different things which are produced just by government, let alone other people. So for me, partly, my office will make the official system, protect it and make it work better. But much more importantly, is this reach beyond. The reach beyond is a difficult thing, because there are people to persuade who don't yet even know about trustworthiness, quality, and value. A Guy's point, you know, they publish things with no confidence intervals, or as you put it, much more. Colourfully crap. That's what I want this office to do. That's the big challenge. So the glib answer is, we'll work with the system to make it better. And actually, I suppose that to make it a bit less good, I don't think it's just me who does it. I think there are 5,000 people in the GSS. I think there's a broader statistics community outside that. There's fantastic organisations like the RSS and like Full Fact, and I think there's a crusade that we can go together. And I think maybe what we're now doing in my office, it's not like we've invented this crusade. The crusade has been going on. We're joining it. And I think in the past, when we were just a monitoring assessment team within the authority, or other invisible thing, we weren't really on the crusade. We were just in our little walled garden, and we're now stepping outside. So let's take some.
Would you have
a few
questions?
Thanks for a great talk. And also Woody Collins, Statistics User Forum. I've got something on my mind as an educator, and it's about lessons we can learn from quantities. I keep having an image of Admiral Nelson holding the telescope to his blind eye and saying, I see no ships. And the more contact I have with senior politicians, the more I think they use that model. But you mentioned a famous bus with 350 million pounds on it. And that was an extraordinary moment in statistics.
Yeah.
Also last year, I think shortly before that, Oxfam, one of the NGOs you were talking about, put up their amazing data, I don't know how accurate it is, but saying that it took half the world's population, over 3 billion,
yeah,
it had the same wealth as 85 people that you could put in a London bus.
Yeah.
So buses figured in two astonishing statistics.
Yeah.
Now, people sent me the Oxfam numbers in Spanish, Italian, every charity I'm involved with sent some version of that figure on the grotesque distribution of wealth on our planet. I know people saw it on both sides of the Atlantic and in the Southern Hemisphere. Not a word from any policymaker I could think of either side of the Atlantic. Absolute deafening silence, even while my Facebook pages for days were full of versions of it. What can we learn from that Oxfam statistic, which was even more striking than the bus with 350 million on it?
Well,
and why did they ignore it so easily?
I'm not sure I can answer why they could ignore it so easily, but let's just step into that case again. Do you know like Tim Harford, the FT economic writer? He's done a really nice piece on that where he sort of, but he makes a great joke because he says Oxfam puts out saying there's 85 people would fit on a single double-decker bus. And he says, is that different from a double single-decker bus? Which that's the sort of joke which appeals to me. But he sort of starts to unpick the sources of Oxfam's information, and he kind of does a little bit of a fact check play with it. It's well worth looking at. I think there's really, underneath that, there's a point about what's the intermediation of knowledge and insight. Oxfam hits upon something there, as really, I think, did some of the campaigns in the referendum, hits on a really, really powerful way to package, encapsulate, sort of capture and, you know, using factoids, or maybe you wouldn't call them statistics, factoids, to kind of capture that. And I think that if that's the world we're in, we as an official statistics community have to debate this. So I'm not going to give an answer. The debate is, do we A, say, no, we're the people who will give you the confidence intervals and will give you the caveats that the uncertainties, and we'll explain the context and we'll give you all the things you can and you can't use the statistics. And I think that probably is my answer. That's what we should do. But the other answer you can give is, well, actually, we can't fight that. So what we've got to do is to get in there and we've just got to do a better job of the encapsulation. And so I think there's a really big debate for us to say, do we hold our noses about that world and just say, well, Oxfam can play with numbers, but we do our kind of sober and realistic thing, or do we say, well, actually, we're just going to disappear if we don't enter that sentence. I don't have an answer to it. I think it's a debate that we have to explore quite fully.
We have another question.
Yeah,
sorry.
I'm mainly a user of your data because I head up digital team.
My data?
Oh, well, yeah, your data and data in general because I head up HMRC's digital delivery centres. I also have analysts who work for me as well. What I find this akin to is many, many years ago, with all problems with builders and everything else like that, I would never now get any job done in my house unless the builder has the quality mark on it. Yeah. Never ever get a gas person unless they have the quality mark on it and everything else like that. And that's where I think you sit, because we've used your data, because we're the digital, we do things like tax credits, and we get told, you know, 20% of people don't have digital access. But actually, your data tells us that 20% is mainly made up of people over 60, of which people mainly over 60 don't get child benefit, don't get tax credit. So we can trust your data and make decisions because it has that time mark on it. And so the regulatory part of it, in a world of uncertainty, I'm getting more that the only data I trust is if it has your time mark on it. Like, I will never imply it. You could be the best builder in the world, but if you don't have that corgi thing, you're not doing gas in my house.
Mm. Yeah.
And that's because of what's gone before. I think we're getting there with data now. We're getting to the stage where people don't trust it. Yeah. So actually, your role is greater rather than less in the world. More people like me are turning more to you because everything else is uncertain. We're saying, well, I'll do so.
That's fantastic. That's fantastic. Thank you very much. I mean, the pedant in me says it's not really my data. It's my kite mark.
It's your kite mark.
It's my kite mark. But the enthusiast in me sort of rejoices because if people like you say that, it means that our emphasis on this brand is really working.
And so that's like great. I said, it is a time up because it's like that corgi fitter, yeah, might come from this company or come from that.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
It's not him that I trust, it's the time mark that I trust.
Yeah. Yeah.
So as long as you keep that reputation, which you've got really high at the moment, I think you'll get more people trusting you more because of how much is going on there.
Can we stop now? Yeah. That's not. I'm sorry, there's some brilliant other questions.
Saying at the conference in September, we had a session on building trust, which you're welcome to come to if you're attending.
So thank you very much.
I think, do we have any more questions or sorry, keeping you as well. Should we have two more questions? Should we come into that?
This is a comment really on what Willie said, but just I think we do need to be brave to become statisticians who also could become journalists actually, or to interpret our data appropriately and to bust Jeremy Hunt's claims or actually to speak out about what is inappropriate in interpretation of statistics. A lot louder and be brave.
We're in the house of Spiegelhalter here.
Yeah. He does. We need more of him, and I'm trying to be more of it.
I think there's a big conflict you have between the trustworthiness of the data and the usefulness of the data, particularly our population estimates, which is something I used to do. When I did it, we would publish single year age data for England and Wales, broad ages for counties, and for individual local authorities, only males and females. People kept coming to us and saying, we want age structures for individual local authorities, we want to buy single year age for local authorities. We said, you can't do it. They said, we need it. So how do you reconcile people demanding more and more detail with the fact that such detail would be rubbish?
I think that goes to the point about sort of, in a way, it goes back to Margaret's point about confidence. There's something in the confidence in saying clearly in your metadata what your statistics can and can't be used reliably for. And when you see people doing that, it really works well. Let me give an example. For last year's, maybe it was the year before last, official statistics, RSS official statistics prize winner was the Welsh indices of multiple deprivation. Anybody here responsible for that fantastic output? Anybody used it?
Mm-hmm.
It's great. And the thing which won it was that they are so clear about this is what this means and this is what it doesn't mean. And I think that one should never say, we're not going to make this data available because, in a way there's a little bit of a closedness to that. Make data available, but have a confidence in the metadata. And maybe you're going to have a confidence to say most crap as well.